This episode of the Virginia History Podcast is brought to you in part by Brandon Huebner, our newest patron. For more about how you too can become a patron of the Virginia History Podcast, stay tuned to the end of this episode for more details. But before I start, let me also put in a good word for Brandon's incredible show, the Maritime History Podcast. If you have yet to come across his work, then you're missing out. Brandon details maritime history from as far back as records will allow. He's currently covering ancient Greece, which is full of extraordinary tales coming from the many sea battles to have taken place in a land colored by seafaring. Details about where to find the Maritime History Podcast will be in the show notes page for this episode. Check it out!
Carry me back to
The Royal Colony of Virginia, though in effect since 1624, was completely and finally established in 1642. King Charles had never seemed to take a real interest in Virginia's affairs before Berkeley's arrival. Because of the king's aloofness, rumors constantly swirled both at home and in the colony. Chief among those rumors was one that the Virginia Company would be revived, and the colony would once again become a charter company. Many in Virginia wanted nothing to do with a revived Virginia Company. Elders who could remember the pre-1624 era shivered at the prospect. Those who were born in Virginia or came after 1624 never knew a different life than the one they'd experienced up until 1642. Everyone wanted to know on which side of opinion would Berkeley land. His decision was momentous in that it set the colony's course for many years to come. It was equally momentous for another reason. There were those who supported the company's revival, and they were powerful men with powerful connections. They were many of the men who comprised the Matthews-Claiborne faction. And half of that faction supported Parliament during the English Civil War. Against such opposition, could William keep the company champions at bay? Could he keep Virginia a royal colony? Major 17th century Virginia figures came together in April 1642. It was Berkeley's first meeting of the General Assembly, and the big issue on the table was that Virginia Company question. Men like Benjamin Harrison, Thomas Willoughby, Argall Yardley, Samuel Matthews, and Richard Bennett, to name a few, arrived in Jamestown to convene the Assembly. They wanted to see who this new governor was and test his authority. William Berkeley extended hospitality to all comers, great or small. He immediately showed that he cared about Virginia's welfare, even if at times he could be outspoken concerning differing viewpoints. After the assembly formed on April 1, 1642, the business at hand was presented. George Sands, Edwin Sands' brother, was appointed treasurer of the colony by the 1639 Legislative Assembly. Since that time, Sands had moved to revive the Virginia Company by organizing and sending a formal petition to the English House of Commons. The plan was to put Virginia back under the former company, but allow the crown the right to appoint a governor as it saw fit. After a few days' debate in which the matter was fully argued from all angles, the governor and council issued a statement declaring George Sands to be mistaken in his petition. Reviving the company would, in their opinion, be a disaster. And if it were revived, the colonists would essentially revolt. Rather than submit all facets of life under a monopolistic enterprise, Virginians wanted to freely trade with whomever they pleased. they wanted the opportunity to set their own trade terms, something they couldn't do under the company's structure. Further, whenever the colonists sold anything under the company's model, they had to sell to the company's central storehouse, which meant that received payment was low, if at all. Another major concern under the company guidelines stipulated that a colonist couldn't return to England with, as Edward Neill wrote, the fruits of his labor. A colonist returning to England was required to exchange his earnings for useless wares. No one wanted to return to that nonsensical form of governance. They had all benefited from freedoms created since 1624. Their annual assemblies, local governments, legal trials, and ability to freely petition the crown set Virginia on a sound footing, one that had never been seen before 1624. Not fully, at least. Finally, and most importantly, if the company came back into power, then all land grants in the king's name would be, in their minds, illegal. This was no small concern. The company did allow for private property in small measure as early as 1613, with increasing allotments allowed in 1616 and 1618. But realistically, that land was still part of the company's holdings. On the other hand, land granted by the king, in their minds, was fully, legally theirs. Even today, some families who can trace their lineage back to the royal colony still have royal patents signifying their land grant from centuries ago. But if the Charter of 1618 were reenacted, those grants could have been nullified. According to the Assembly, the 1618 Charter stated, "We do ordain that all persons as of their own voluntary will and authority shall remove into Virginia without any grant from us," that is the king's grantees, "in a great and general quarter court, in writing, under our seals, shall be declared as they are, occupiers of our land, that is of the common lands of us, the said treasurer and company." What a tricky clause. In the minds of the 1642 Assembly, enactment of such a clause would destroy the colony overnight. The Assembly simply wouldn't stand for it. They were loyal subjects of the king, a king that had bestowed great blessings upon them, blessings that would be lost under the company. Instead, the Assembly, influenced by Governor Berkeley, argued that they never upon any terms wanted to revive the company. They were obedient to the crown alone, and anyone aiding or abetting the company's revival would be deemed an enemy of the state, and that person's land would be forfeited. To ensure royal authority over Virginia, the Assembly's concerns and oath of allegiance to the king were formally written and sent in April 1642. With the letter completed, the body then disbanded until June 2nd, hoping that would be enough time for their voices to be heard in England and the king's reply to make its way back across the Atlantic. It was enough time. Charles responded kindly to his Virginian subjects. But what did King Charles' reply matter by the time it was read in Virginia? The English Civil War was beginning. It's not the purpose of this podcast to detail the English Civil War, but let me offer a very brief summary. Events leading to the war, or more properly wars, because there were three separate closely related conflicts, began just after Queen Elizabeth died. She had no heir, thus allowing the throne to pass to her next closest relative, and that relative happened to be the son of Queen Mary of Scots, her cousin. The very same woman that Elizabeth had under house arrest before ultimately having her beheaded in 1567. Before Mary died, she gave birth to a son named James in 1566. He was crowned King James VI a year later, and eventually came to rule Scotland in his own right by 1581. James had a rigorous Calvinistic upbringing as he was being groomed for the Scottish throne. Part of that upbringing soon developed into his idea of the divine right of kings, a belief that he was God's chosen ruler. That belief forged into an iron will after much trouble plagued his youth. By 1597, King James had penned his complete thoughts concerning his divine right theory in two works, the Basilicon Doron and the True Law of Free Monarchies. A tremendous aspect of that belief, shared by other monarchs such as Louis XIV and James' son Charles I, had it that no one could challenge the king's final authority. Thus, James ruled Scotland with very little opposition after he overcame his early struggles. Because of James' well-known governmental stance, when Elizabeth died and James ascended to the throne in 1603, the English were quite concerned. They had been developing a more constitutional form of monarchy for centuries, as Parliament became increasingly powerful. Parliament's creation and increasing authority was central to this evolution, but Parliament was hardly a permanent establishment. Those in the body felt threatened by James's rise, which prompted plots against the king's life, such as the infamous 1605 gunpowder plot. But all attempts against James's life failed, unless you accept historian Benjamin Woolley's belief that George Villiers poisoned the king to death. Either way, James continued ruling England until he died in 1625. During that time, James and his wife, Queen Anne of Denmark, produced 7 children, of which sadly only 3 survived to their teenage years or beyond. Of the 3 who did survive an early fate, Prince Henry, the beloved by many, died at age 18, which sent the country into mourning. Prince Charles and Princess Elizabeth, however, lived into their adulthood. James raised Charles and Elizabeth in his divine right tradition. Thus, when Charles succeeded his father to the English throne, the divine right tradition continued. In fact, Charles was even more belligerent about his ultimate authority than his much more peace-loving father. That stance quickly earned Charles many enemies at home and abroad. Charles' marriage to Henrietta Maria, the daughter of French King Henry IV and Marie de Medici, the latter of whom was a violently despised Catholic, did him no favors in England. As Charles' tenure lengthened into the 1630s, English Protestants, as well as the Scottish Kirk, balked at seemingly pro-Catholic decisions that Charles made by divine right. English Parliament also endured a rocky relationship with their king. He constantly ran into trouble with members who held opposing views about a wide array of issues, but mostly concerning finances, the one area that Parliament held great sway. Soon Charles had enough with his early parliaments and dissolved the body altogether in 1629, while also arresting potential threats against his authority. No Parliament held session for 11 years, until Scottish issues prompted the king to recall the body in 1640. He needed funds to fight the First Bishops' War. But that parliament was dissolved 3 weeks later, earning the moniker Short Parliament. As we've already seen in previous episodes, the Bishops' War was a debacle, and Charles suffered for it. He was then forced to recall Parliament to handle the Bishops' War's financial fallout. This would be the last parliament that Charles convened. It lasted essentially until 1660, but Charles wasn't around to see the end of it. Tensions soon erupted between Parliament and the king quickly after the body came together. Charles called the assembly into existence to answer his bankrupt financial situation and lost wars. But Parliament took another route, and opened an irreparable breach by impeaching Charles' men William Laud, Archbishop of Canterbury, and John Finch, the Speaker of the House of Commons. Next came Parliament's uncovering of a very serious conspiracy, apparently led by one Thomas Wentworth, Earl of Strafford. Wentworth had apparently penned a note in which he said, "Sir, you have done your duty, and your subjects have failed in theirs, and therefore you are absolved from the rules of government, and may supply yourself by extraordinary ways. You have an army in Ireland, with which you may reduce the kingdom." When this note came to light, Wentworth was accused of high treason among other crimes, but proof of the claim was kept hidden for a while by one of King Charles' loyalists. Parliament then made a series of more emphatic demands that attacked the king's authority. Charles had hoped that Wentworth's beheading would end the increasing tension, but he was wrong. Soon, issues in Ireland erupted into war, and Charles seemingly supported the Irish Catholics, which incensed Parliament. Word of the parliamentary stance reached Charles, who marched an army into the meeting. They were to arrest the men deemed dangerous to his authority. But the king's men left empty-handed as Parliament stood against their sovereign. The situation continued to deteriorate for months as localities prepared for the worst. Charles marched around England, raising his standard and collecting loyalist troops to his cause, while Parliament raised support, including a cavalry detachment, led by a somewhat unknown Oliver Cromwell. Then the line was finally and undoubtedly crossed at the Battle of Edge Hill on October 23rd, 1642. The war was on. While the king and parliament were organizing armies to fight across the British Isles, Berkeley was busy undoing potential opposition to his rule in Virginia. He made sure to blunt any threat that the Matthews-Claiborne faction might offer by approving all of Sir Francis Wyatt's work concerning local governments. This move appeased Wyatt and any supporter who might have been upset concerning the former governors being replaced. Berkeley next repealed a poll tax that directly served to benefit only himself. By this action, the assembly quickly realized that this man was different than Virginia's previous governors. Accordingly, they rewarded his work by granting him more property on and around Jamestown to offset lost income. While Berkeley deftly handled Virginia's leading men, another issue arose, the seeds of which were planted before the new governor's arrival. Settlers along the Nansemond River and Upper Norfolk had sought ministers for their church vacancies. Lack of ministers was a considerable issue throughout the entire colony, especially considering how rapidly land was settled during the 1620s to 1640s. Finding new ministers proved to be a problem because few, if any, well-taken care of Anglican ministers wanted to go to Virginia. But that's not to say there weren't men willing to minister. They just weren't Anglican. And many of the Virginia congregations looking for their ministers were also not Anglican. They were Calvinist Puritans. During the 1630s, a massive influx of Puritans flooded the New World and settled into Massachusetts Bay. So, the Calvinist Virginian churches looking for ministers sent Philip Bennett to Boston as their representative searching for Puritan leaders. Puritans such as Philip Bennett, descendant of Richard Bennett from Bennett's Welcome near modern-day Smithfield, were not new to Virginia. They had been coming since the 1620s. For the most part, they dwelt peacefully with their fellow English settlers. But with the advent of Civil War, their position in the colony grew more tense. Governor Berkeley was a staunch Anglican and supporter of the crown. Yet Puritans sided with Parliament, both ecclesiastically and governmentally. The arrival of Puritan ministers, notably those who had opposed Archbishop William Laud, posed what Berkeley thought to be a considerable threat. So the governor moved to squelch a potential rebellion when he influenced the assembly to pass an updated oath of allegiance. It stated, "For the preservation of the purity of doctrine and unity of the church, that all men whatsoever which shall reside in the colony are to be conformable to the orders and constitution of the Church of England and the laws therein established, and not otherwise to be admitted to teach publicly or privately, and that the Grand Council do take care that all nonconformists upon notice of shall be compelled to depart the colony with all convenience." In other words, submit to the Anglican Church or get out. Berkeley's influence also extended to Roman Catholics. No supporters of the Pope could hold office unless they take the oath of allegiance and supremacy. Further, no priest could remain in the colony longer than 5 days after being notified by Berkeley. Virginia was to be Anglican by royal, governmental decree, and enforced by Governor Berkeley. Realistically, however, it was extraordinarily difficult to ensure that everyone was Anglican, or even went to church for that matter. There just weren't enough governmental officers to patrol the colony, nor were there enough churches to service an expanding Virginia. Not in the 1640s, at least. Regardless, in all cases, Berkeley followed the doctrine of popular sovereignty and allowed settlers in their own locales to decide what was best for them. And they did so, except for the issue of the Puritans. But settlers who desired Puritan teachings circumvented the government in the same way that the early Christians had done. They met in private houses. Still, Berkeley's pressure proved to be too much for the Puritans' guilty consciences. They didn't wish to offend Virginia's governor, and those who came from Boston left the colony in 1643. Berkeley's anti-Puritan stance was a leading cause that eventually cost him his governorship in that it drew attention from Robert Rich, the second Earl of Warwick. The Riches had been involved in Virginia for quite some time. Robert Rich, the first Earl of Warwick, had famously gifted the treasurer, the ship upon which Pocahontas was kidnapped, to the Virginia Company, as well as supported piracy against the Spanish Empire. It was his piracy that directly led to the capture of the 20 and odd Negroes mentioned by John Rolfe in 1619. The Riches were also involved on the land, as well as the sea. They established Rich Neck Plantation in the county so named by 1634 royal decree for Robert Rich, the second Earl of Warwick. Warwick River Shire, later Warwick County, and now today's Newport News, was one of the 8 original shires created to extend local government away from Jamestown. Robert Rich, the second Earl of Warwick, was no pushover. He was as much a somebody as William Berkeley, and Rich had a navy at his disposal to use against any anti-Puritan antagonism. He issued letters of marque to his captains in which he authorized them to capture any pro-royalist ships entering English ports. In addition, Rich spread word abroad that Virginians would be freed from taxation, and when the governor's office became vacant again, they'd be allowed to choose their own governor. This proved to be a tricky situation for Berkeley, who had many royalist supporters around him. But those supporters started to see their bottom lines take a hit. A potential suffering merchant was William Claiborne, who up until this point was in England watching his country devolve into war. But though he was in England, Claiborne's shadow still extended into Virginia, and Berkeley knew this. So, the governor had to figure out how to handle this important character. He restored Claiborne to the governing council, an elevated place that Claiborne had lost under John Harvey, and also made him treasurer of the colony. Both of Berkeley's moves were admirable, but with Claiborne's lifelong hatred of the Maryland Calverts, as well as his siding with Parliament in the English Civil War, soon proved to be painful sores in Berkeley's side. So painful that Claiborne's influence greatly aided in ending Berkeley's first gubernatorial tenure. How all of that happened, however, we'll have to wait until the next episode. Thank you again for supporting the podcast. I greatly appreciate it. Please continue to spread the word and help this colony to keep growing. Start by following us on your favorite podcast provider, like us on Facebook and Instagram, and visit the website. Sharing episodes and other work is the best way to expand the community. Another way to greatly aid the podcast is by providing feedback on iTunes. If you have yet to do so, please take a few minutes and leave us a comment. Doing so helps bring exposure in the iTunes network. If you would like to do more to help out, please consider supporting the podcast on Patreon. Links can be found on the website, or one can visit the campaign at patreon.com/VAHISPOD to see the choices and rewards being offered for your generosity. There are other ways to contribute to our work. Please check the website's support tab to see all of the available options. Your generosity is much appreciated and goes a long way toward building this colony. Please join me next time as we continue witnessing Virginia's growth under Governor Berkeley. But this time, Berkeley begins enduring serious opposition, both old and new. Mas é...